Hello, my name is Akshat Tangsale, and you are watching first of the recorded video lectures in the flipped learning mode for the unit Introduction to Process Simulation. Let's look at the learning outcomes for this part of the chapter. First, we will look at how to present and prepare process flow diagrams. We'll simulate the process to model material energy balances in Aspen Plus and in Excel, and we will simulate user-specified models and components when a simulator does not have what we need, and we learn to converge flow sheets. So according to George Box, all models are wrong, but some are useful. It's a useful statement because what we need to understand is what are the limitations of the simulation and the models that we are generating, because some of the models may get closer to the reality than some others. But the usefulness of the model can only be known if you know the limitation of those models. So let's look at process simulation. In simulation, we are trying to model the actual process by essentially conducting experiments in the computer simulation. So the aim is to generate a process flow sheet to perform steady state mass and energy balance, which then leads to sizing and costing of a chemical process. We can use this in designing new plants or improving the performance of existing operating plants. The design objective is of the flow sheet is systematically investigation of different alternatives which can be developed for a defined problem. So in other words, we can optimize the flow sheet according to how we want the final outcome to be. So this is in the design of the process flow sheet. When we are trying to do a flow sheet for an operation, then it becomes more challenging because we can't optimize it to what we need. Instead, we want to model what is actually happening in the real world. So the mathematical models and the thermodynamic models should be able to capture all the real world details so that the plant data can be reconciled. Only by doing that, then we can start understanding the process and then hopefully improve the existing plant operations. So the first step of any process simulation is to be able to develop a block flow diagram first. And this is obviously for designing a new process. And then we select the unit operations like vessels, heat exchangers, pumps, etc. Then we want to do a mass and energy balance for the process and to start evaluating the process in more detail. The simulation is also a starting point for equipment design. So only once we have done the process flow simulation, we can go on to look at each equipment in that process flow sheet and then size them and then design them. In most companies, mass energy balance are developed using Aspen Plus or CAD-CAM, ProChem or Unisim, but Aspen Plus is by far one of the most widely used process simulator. Each program has its own advantages and disadvantages, but as a department of chemical engineering at Monash, we've found, having used HYSYS before, that Aspen Plus gives us more versatility and captures a lot more programs or a lot more systems that we can simulate. Of course, not all programs, not all processes can be simulated. So in those cases, we can use Excel for mass energy balance. Process flow sheet development can be done with other programs. Note, we can use the simulation only after we have done the PFD, but often it's an iterative process. So you can do a PFD by looking at the block flow diagram and unit operation selection and then do the simulation. But after doing the simulation, you may find that you need some heat exchangers, for example, to adjust the process temperature. Then you may have to go back and redo the PFD and come back and simulate it again. So it can be an iterative process. The simulators are set up in a way that we only see the graphical user interface, so what we see on a computer screen, and we enter all our commands through that graphical user interface. In the middle, we have an executive program, so that program then thinks where that information should go, and then accordingly it can pull out a subroutine like equipment subroutine. So this could be the blocks or thermodynamic subroutines, which is in the properties methods, or when we are doing optimization or convergence, then it can look up the packages for those and physical property data from experimental data or thermodynamic data that is built into the properties simulation. We won't be going into cost data too much in this unit, but obviously Aspen Plus has got costing models also. The way Aspen Plus works is it has two types of programs for calculating mass balances. One of them is what is called a sequential modeler. In this, each block is solved in an order, typically from left to right, and where there is a recycle block or a recycle stream, it will assign a tear stream to that recycle stream and then do an iterative solution in sequence, and after several iterations it may be able to solve a large number of blocks. So often it can be quite time consuming, especially if you have lots of recycle streams, or if you have heat integration, which means a hot process stream is integrated with cold process streams to transfer energy from hot to cold streams. A better approach for certain types of problems could be equation-oriented programming or equation-oriented simulation, where all the equations or all the blocks, in other words, are solved simultaneously. And therefore, in this case, if you have a heavily recycled stream, you may need a good guess or a good starting point for each of those recycled streams. So one of the good ways to set up a complex problem is to first do program or simulation in a sequential modeler mode. Once you have solved it, all the initial guesses will be available to you on those stream flow rates, and then you can switch to equation-oriented simulation and then change certain parameters so that you can do calculations on some of those streams. We will go in a few more details, and you will do a tutorial on both of these when we look into that in this week's tutorials. So ideally, you should use a sequential modeler approach when you have a large number of unit operation but few recycle loops, and you can use it for initial PFT development and as a first step for regress modeling using equation-oriented programming or equation-oriented approach. Whereas the equation-oriented approach should ideally be left for rigorous modeling like highly heat-integrated process, highly recycled process, or processes which can have many design specifications, such as the purity of the products or conversion of the reactants and so on. Or you can use it for process optimization. So you can set up the whole flow sheet, and then you can change the reactor temperature, for example, and see the effect of reactor temperature as you increase what happens to the process stream. It can also be used to model the data that has been given to you from experimental available data. In Aspen Plus, we have both steady state and dynamic simulation. However, in this unit, we are only going to look at steady state environment, but it's good to know what's available out there. So in steady state simulation environment, we have the database that is available to us, thermodynamic modeling available to us, and we can do feasibility studies of new design, analysis of complex plants with recycle and optimization. So typically it's used for either operation, so looking at what is the operating window of a chemical plant, or sensitivity analysis, or diagnosing certain problems, or doing maintenance. So before doing an actual maintenance of an operational vessel, we can do the simulation on Aspen Plus, and then go back and use those in the actual plant. It can be used for revamping an existing plant, like heat integration, or equipment upgrade or waste minimization. The steady state model can also be used for systems analysis, integrations, interactions between various sections of the plan, looking at alternative flow sheets and optimization and design. The dynamic simulation is normally done when things are changing with time. And in this case, you have three options. You can have Aspen Plus Dynamics, Aspen Custom Modeler, or Aspen Batch Modeler. So the Aspen Plus Dynamics, you have dynamic flow sheet interface with the Aspen Plus. So Aspen Plus does the steady state flow sheeting, and the Aspen Plus Dynamics is interfaced with the steady state flow sheet to do the dynamic calculation. The Aspen Custom Modeler is a modeling environment on a user add-on Unix. So we can define our own unit and do a programming of that dynamic simulation. Aspen Batch Modeler is a reactor modeler where you can have semi-batch or batch systems, and you can do reaction kinetic models on those. So these dynamic models can be used for operation of startup, shutdown, or looking at safety operations of an operating plant. We can use a dynamic plant-wide control, or it can be used for operator training in the industry, or it can be used for real-time optimization of a chemical plant. Let's look at some details of steady-state simulation in Aspen Plus. Our general starting point would be a process description, which is given by a client. In our case, a process description will be given in a problem statement. And we may be given some design specifications, such as purity of a stream or external constraints like EPA guidelines on the composition of the effluent. So certain toxic or hazardous chemicals are guided by EPA to have below certain limits. The first step to convert a process description is to first make a block flow diagram and then convert that block flow diagram into a process flow diagram, both of which we have covered in the past few weeks. And then finally, this process flow diagram can be converted to process simulation diagram, or PSD, which we are going to do now. The general step for problem analysis for any process simulation diagram is to know what input and output streams we will have. So we will enter all the components, essentially. We look at the thermodynamic issues. So in other words, decide which property method to use in Aspen. We look at what reactor systems we need, whether it's an adiabatic reactor or isothermal reactor, or we can use either simple models like R-Gibbs or complex models like kinetic models of R-Plug and R-CSTR and so on. And we'll come to that when we do the reactors in a couple of weeks' time. Reactor separation and recycle systems, we look at how these are arranged and which unit operation will be used for separation systems. And then finally, we control all the flow sheet specifications by applying design specifications, and then transform all the real units into simulation units. So it's not necessary to have one for one block in process flow diagram and in process simulation diagram. The package Aspen Plus does the degrees of freedom analysis for us, and it also assigns stair streams and computational sequence. However, we can, as user, define the tear stream if we want. This is for a sequential modeler approach. And also we can define the computational sequence in the sequential modeler approach. However, for now, we are going to leave that alone, and Aspen will choose the tear stream and computational sequence for us. To build large flow sheets, a good starting point is to first use a few blocks, and then simulate them, get them to work first, and then we can join new blocks to it. By doing that, we can troubleshoot the errors easily. Say you have four blocks working properly, you add the fifth block and suddenly you get an error. We know how to troubleshoot that. But in case, if you start off with all five blocks and you encounter a problem, it can be hard to find where the problem was. Also, if you have a recycle loop, it's good practice to first solve for single pass, that is without connecting any recycle streams, get that to work properly without any warning, without any errors, and then we can connect the recycle loop. Also, it's not necessary to have one block for each piece of equipment, as I've mentioned before. We can use custom modeler for any novel piece of equipment, but we won't be going into that much detail. We should also keep in mind that what is the end use of the model. Often the simple flow sheets which run fast are more useful than complex flow sheets which takes forever to solve. So it's always good idea to make as simple a flow sheet as possible, which means we don't have any heat integration and leave all the recycle loops for later, and only do all of this complex problems when we can do the simple flow sheet properly. We also need to ensure that the flow sheet inputs are all quite reasonable. For example, the energy input that we need to put in, or any thermodynamic package that we need to put in, are all quite reasonable for the actual process. And at the end, obviously, we need to validate the results. So we can do that by doing hand calculation or having some sense of whether the answer is realistic and valid or not. So to begin any simulation in Aspen Plus, we need to first go to Properties Environment, and all the steps needed to fulfill the physical properties must be entered here. So on this right-hand side, you can see a screenshot of the properties method. The first step would be normally to enter all the components and then select the property method. We collect all the experimental property data to check to fit our model. We will do a tutorial on that. We also look at property estimation and structure drawing in case we have a user-defined component. Not all components are available, so if it's a very complex molecule like amino acid, for example, it may not be available in Aspen Plus. So we need to define that, and we need to draw the structure of that molecule. We also can do property analysis. For example, we can generate vapor liquid equilibrium data in Aspen Plus. And we can do property data regression, which means we can plot our model data against the experimental data for, let's say, vapor liquid equilibrium, and see whether our property method is suitable for the given system. In the simulation environment, we can build and run the model. So this is where we add all the blocks and the process flow streams and build the process flow stream. So here we can create and run interactive analysis, do sensitivity analysis, do case studies, do optimization, and so on. So here we fit all the process or lab data if possible, do preliminary equipment design, sizing, and rating. So for example, for a catalyst, catalytic bed, we can calculate how much catalyst is required for that reactor. And we can also do relative cost estimation, although in this unit, we will not go into economic evaluation. So let's look at the properties environment. This is how the screenshot for the component specification looks like. So we can select all the components that we want by either clicking on find or just simply enter the component ID in this. Here we can also select which data banks to use. There are several choices of data banks available. Typically, just choosing pure aqueous, solid, and inorganic should be sufficient. However, if there are electrolytes or polymers or other novel compounds, then we may have to choose a proper data bank for that. The next step is to go to methods. So here we have a methods section, and here we can choose a method that we want. In this case, RK-SWAB, which is an equation of state model, has been chosen. We can use methods assistant by clicking on this button here, and it will guide you through step-by-step method selection. We will again obviously practice that when we go to do the tutorials. So that's it for today's lecture, and I'll continue with the process simulation in the next lecture. Thank you.